Okay, I think we're good. I think we're good. This is definitely a learning experience. Hello, everybody who's watching live. Welcome to MicroCamp. It's a bit of an experiment. This is our first like full virtual, remote conference for micro.blog. We are learning a lot already, and I'm sure we want to do this again. We want this to be something that we can do regularly, and so we are already taking notes about figuring out the best way to do this. But I just wanted to start by thanking everybody for being here and also all the speakers who put their talks together ahead of time. Those will be coming up on the hour today and then again tomorrow. We're going to have more sessions. And so it's been really fun to see this come together. And like I said, we're learning a lot and really appreciate all the feedback and questions. And Gene and I are going to talk today. I'm going to just talk briefly to kick things off, and then Gene's going to talk about the community a little bit, and then we'll open it up for questions. So if you're on Vito, feel free to post some questions, and we have a couple other questions we got on micro.blog to start things off. But today I wanted to start with just a few things. One, kind of the state of micro.blog, how we're thinking about things 4 years in to this grand experiment. And then also talk a little bit about what we're working on this year. So first of all, micro.blog continues to grow. Like, we grow pretty slowly, but we keep growing and welcoming new people into the community every day, which is just really exciting. The problem with building a social network usually is that there's this network effect of, you join, but none of your friends are there, and then there's not enough people, and the timeline is empty. And our solution to that was really, if we base this on blogs, we can solve a couple problems. We can make things about content ownership and owning your own content at the same time while we focus on the community and the timeline. But we can also provide like value right away. So people, they can come in and like, personally, I love to blog. And so I find value in blogging, even if nobody or just like a couple people are listening. And so I feel like over the last few years, we've proven that that works. Like, build something that is valuable, keep making it better. And then the nice thing is that it's useful to people right away, but also people stick around. And then all of a sudden, before you know it, the timeline is more full and rich and diverse, and you're getting replies. And then the community grows from there. So I'm really happy about the way things are going. And I'm really thankful to everybody who has given micro.blog a chance. And so going forward, I feel like last year, we spent a lot of time on some big features. We called it micro.blog 2.0. We rolled out updates to the native apps and the web apps, and we redesigned some things. And we rolled out a whole Teams feature for work or family for multiple accounts. And I think as the year was winding down, we realized this year is not going to be about a lot of big new things. It's going to be about focusing and improving the things that we already have and just making them better. And so the two things I wanted to mention today that we are actively working on, the first is photos. We love photos. The great thing about photos is, even if you join and you feel like maybe you don't have anything to say or you're not sure what to blog about, everybody has a photo that they took that is interesting that people will find beautiful or interesting or just unique in some way. So photos are a great way to get started, and we want to do a lot more with photos. And that also includes updating our iOS app, Sunlit. This is the app that I've been working on with John Hayes for a long time. It actually predates micro.blog a little bit, and we've been rolling out improvements to that. We open sourced that project also, so you can get a little bit of look behind the scenes if you're a developer, want to see how things are going. And we have some more improvements to that just to make it smoother, adding check-ins and locations, starting to introduce that into micro.blog. We've always been real conscious of just like the privacy aspect and never accidentally sharing your information and not even recording it in most cases. But we want to slowly start enabling that for people that want to share, like they checked into a coffee shop or a restaurant or their workplace. So we're doing a lot more with photos, photo challenges, things like that for the community. And then the other thing I wanted to mention was just the infrastructure. There are lots of little things with micro.blog that some people have probably noticed where Every once in a while, there's a glitch or the secure version of your site needs to be renewed, or things aren't as fast publishing as they could be. So really going in and making all of that more robust. And a big part of that, I feel like a big step forward for the whole web platform, was hiring Vincent Ritter in a part-time basis, helping us out. We just did that last month, and it's already been super valuable to have someone else on the team giving feedback, a fresh set of eyes on the code, and also just contributing right away to bug fixes and improvements. One thing I don't think we've announced yet, but he has been working, hopefully he doesn't mind me mentioning this, he's been working on dark mode support on the web, and it looks beautiful. So I can't wait to show everybody that. And as part of that, I've been talking to him about server improvements. I didn't want to roll this out before Micro.blog, but we have an upgrade for how the backend publishing and serving of hosted blogs works, that after Microcamp wraps up, we will roll that out, and that'll be a really nice kind of stability improvement that I think hopefully you don't notice. Hopefully you just notice when there's fewer problems. So those are the two big things I wanted to focus on today, just because that's on my mind a lot this year, is just making things better. We've made a whole bunch of improvements this year, little bug fixes, little performance improvements, but there is a lot more to do and a lot more we want to do. So with that, I'm going to pass it off to you, Gene. I've talked enough for the start. All right, let's get back. So thanks everybody for your patience. We are back with just a live audio stream for this opening session while I work out the technical difficulties. Thank you, Jason Burke, for jumping in and live streaming the audio. So with that, I'm going to hand it off to Jean, and she'll talk about the community, and then we'll get into some questions.
Oh my God. All my visual aids out the window. No, I really actually had none. So what I was trying to say when we found out nobody could really hear me is I wanted to start off with a big thank you to the Kickstarter backers, because it has been over 4.5 years since the Kickstarter launched, and that's hard to believe, but certainly I'm grateful because of you all who contributed back then when Manton met his first, shall I say, very unambitious goal of $10,000, and raised it to $80,000 with the caveat that he would hire a community manager if he hit that goal. And I saw that post and I was like, huh, sounds like a great job for me, even though I've never been exactly a community manager in my software career. But I was just really drawn to the whole Micro.blog mission. And it's turned out to be like my favorite job ever. And I wanted to tell you a few things about what I see is the state of the Micro.blog community, and also where we've come from, how we've evolved, and some of the goals that I have and that Manton and I have. One of the things that's pretty popular on Micro.blog is the Discover timeline. And if people were around in the beginning, well, there wasn't even a Discover timeline, but we were trying to figure out how we could help people find each other without simultaneously making it possible for other people to troll or spam them, and a la other social media timelines that we're familiar with. And so we started out just posting some profiles, like you could follow these people, but that wasn't really sustainable as a manual process. And it also really didn't help people figure out why would they want to follow that person. And so then we started a Discover timeline that was all photo thumbnails, which was kind of cool because you could follow interesting, you know, people through seeing, you know, what they were taking photos of. But eventually we hit on this idea of just posting a timeline that was a sample of what was being posted on micro.blog that day. And that has definitely evolved over time. I think, you know, just the comments that I've received, a lot of people really enjoy the Discover timeline. It started out like I tried to focus more on text micro posts. So, you know, because that's when micro.blog got started, that's where we were focused and not so much on photography or long form posts. And I wanted it to sort of emulate a Twitter timeline, but of course, much higher quality. And then, you know, just over time, I realized, wow, the community is really into posting photos. And, you know, there's, you know, no denying a picture is worth 1,000 words, or at least, you know, 280 characters. So started adding more photos into it. And now the timeline is sort of a hybrid of Twitter style, Instagram style. And I've come to like that. And I feel like it just sets us apart from other places where you might hang out. And I had a lot of interesting feedback on Discover, and we try to focus on what I wanted to tell you. In case you didn't know, it's totally curated by hand. There's no artificial intelligence. You know, as long as you don't believe that I am in fact an Android, I am not, I can tell you. But the curation is not very systematic. We try to feature new folks more frequently, at least in the beginning, so that people, you know, might discover new people, but it's also a way for the new people to discover existing community members. So we do a mix and we try to feature a wide range of people. Sometimes life intervenes and we don't, you know, we miss several hours of posts and they just don't get curated. And I think it's a good time to point out that the Discover timeline is definitely not a collection of our favorite posts or the best posts or the best photos or the best anything. We are not trying to judge your work. We do have some guidelines which are posted in our help documents about what we, you know, what our goals are with Discover, to start conversations, not arguments, is one of them. You know, so for anybody feeling like, oh, they didn't like my post, it didn't show up on Discover, please do not feel that way. It is just, it's a bit haphazard. And over time, you know, of the goals that we have, as Manton mentioned, you know, we started working with Vincent on the development side. We do intend to bring in more curators, hopefully in different time zones. So, that things can happen when I'm not awake and or Manton is not awake. And then, you know, and also to just get a different perspective, because obviously it's a subjective collection of what I feel, you know, represents the micro.blog community. And I wanted to... another thing I wanted to talk about, some of the things that I've noticed as micro.blog has evolved, and sometimes I joke that these are the marketing slogans that I would love to use, but never will, because micro.blog is so special. So one of the slogans I often point to is that micro.blog is it's the social media platform where apologies are accepted. So I have never seen so many sincere discussions where people maybe disagree. And then one person says, you know, I apologize if I sounded too strident. And the other person says, oh, it's okay. I think I was too strident too. I mean, I pretty much have never seen that anywhere else. So the social media where people apologize. Another thing I like about micro.blog is that you could get a reply to your post like days or weeks or even months later. And it doesn't seem weird because we're not, we are the slow social media network, which is another marketing slogan I won't be using, but I think you could all appreciate it. We are not trying to discuss things at breakneck speed. And that brings me to another one of my formulations, which micro.blog, the social media network of cold takes. So you know what it's like to be on Twitter or Facebook and something that is provocative shows up and suddenly within 5 minutes, half of your timeline has an opinion on it. And that's pretty rare for micro.blog. And I appreciate that because really, if I wanted the hot takes, I would spend a lot more time on Twitter. And then another thing that I've noticed over the years is when we first started out, of course, we had a pretty North American centric community. And sometimes I would notice our members from other time zones, you know, in the middle of the night going like, gee, it's so lonely here. Nobody to talk to. I would see those posts when I would wake up. But now when I wake up, I feel like a lot has happened overnight. And like, I'm like, wow. I feel like the hours, you know, when it's nighttime, the middle of the night here are still just as lively as the middle of the day here. And so I now think of it as the community that never sleeps. So I hope, you know, I'd love to hear people's reactions to how they have seen things change over time. And, you know, we can talk about it back on micro.blog. You can always email me at jean@micro.blog. And the final thing I wanted to talk about, which is very important to me, but it's not something I feel I can really address properly in this this setting, and I want you to know that it is on our minds, and we do have a concern about it, which is the diversity of the community. It's we don't count people, we don't do demographics, we don't even know much about you other than what you post, but it's pretty clear for anyone to see that there is a lopsided representation of white guys and, you know, US guys and tech guys. And we are trying, you know, we are trying to think of ways to bring other people to micro.blog so they can see that it might be a good community where they will be welcomed and can participate in fun and civil discussions. I do know when at first, when we first launched and I was sort of querying my female friends who are on other social media platforms, why haven't they signed up for micro.blog? And I did get the answer more than once that they are not really eager to give another social media platform a chance just to be trolled or have their, you know, their high hopes crushed. And I don't blame them. I certainly have come in for my share of, well, not certainly not my share. I mean, I think I've been pretty lucky overall, but I know what it's like to be, you know, to be trolled on Twitter. So one of the things we have to do is reach out more to other other interest groups, other communities, and try to, you know, spread the message about, you know, the mission of micro.blog, which is one, it's a place where you control your blog and you you have your own place on the internet as opposed to being part of a silo, but two, that it's a place for where civility and is valued, and also a place where community guidelines are enforced. And so we have done some marketing where we are trying to reach out to different interest groups. I think if people have noticed, we sponsored a couple of podcasts recently, The Pen Addict, and also Make Do, a crafts and arts and crafts podcast. And I'm open to suggestions of other places to reach out. So again, Jean@micro.blog would be a good place to send those. But you know, if I didn't think we could achieve a better representation, I just wouldn't be here, because as people know, I've been very active in trying to bring more gender equity to the software business. And I have to say, micro.blog is about the most male dominated place I've ever, you know, been involved with. But I'm not pessimistic, I am optimistic. And even when sometimes I feel like it's such an uphill climb, the one thing I do focus on is doing what I can to make this community a place where when somebody does come, who maybe is a little leery because they don't look like everybody else or they don't think like everybody else, that they will notice that this place is different and that we do you know, welcome and value and enjoy having a diversity of experiences and posts. And it's fun for us. It's what makes micro.blog really fun. So with that, I hope that you have a good day at MicroCamp and a good day tomorrow. I'm really, really thankful and grateful to the folks who have willingly come along with us on this big experiment, the presenters whose presentations you will see, and they are also, for the most part, things should go more smoothly because they are pre-recorded, but the presenters themselves will be in the discussion chat that's on our platform here, the Veto Hub. And we scheduled them intentionally that way so that the presenters could be on the side for Q&A as well. Speaking of Q&A, Manton, I know I ran over a little bit on time, or at least we did with our technical difficulties. But yeah. I would like to, if it's okay with you, if we push the schedule out a little bit, just so we can do that.
I think that's great.
We had some questions that were submitted in advance, but I'll also be looking for questions in the chat, and I will be the moderator of this Q&A, and Manton will, for the most part, be the answerer of the Qs. Let me just find those questions, and here they are. So I'm going to start off with Lisa Sievert's question, and Lisa is at Agile Lisa. She's also presenting tomorrow at MicroCamp. And her question is, I'm curious about the Teams plan and whether anyone is using it for families. I'm dreaming about getting my extended family off Facebook and into micro.blog, and it would be great to hear a talk through of how it could work.
That's a great question. So this is something that we spent a lot of time on last year, and we rolled out, we called it Teams, but I definitely had in mind families as well for some use cases. So for example, one of the things that worked really well for me and my family and was to have a blog when we would like travel. Like, so we would do like a road trip, or we went to Europe once, and like being able, anyone in the family being able to post what we were up to that day, I find really interesting, especially going back. Like when I go back and look at that blog from like 5 years ago when we were doing some big road trip across the United States, that is gold. That is like amazing. You know, or like a blog post that my daughter wrote when she was traveling. And like, I find that really interesting. And so I want to encourage that kind of thing on micro.blog. So I'd love to do more to answer the question really about like who's using it and is it a replacement for what some people are doing with Facebook? I feel that not very many people are using it, to be honest. I haven't looked at the subscriptions lately, but it does cost more per month. We charge $20 a month for unlimited number of users. And the design is basically, if you've used micro.blog before and you've created a second blog or like a test blog, when you're in the apps or you're on the web, you can switch. You're signed into one account, but you can switch and post to a different blog. And so that's the way the Teams plan works, is basically you have your own microblog, but you can also post to the shared blog where there are multiple users. And that could be your family. It could just be a few users. So that's the way it works. We haven't had a lot of people take us up on that for families that I've noticed, but I would love for more people to use it. Specifically with Facebook, though, one thing it does not allow is private posts. We have gone back and forth about private posts and how or when to support them in micro.blog many times. I have all sorts of notes about like how I think it could work and like what should be encrypted and what the privacy ramifications are. And to be honest, I don't know. For people who need that, for people who need like private messaging and a private blog, I don't know if we're going to tackle that. Like I think I know how it would work, but it is a kind of a can of worms. And it's the kind of thing that, because we care so much about privacy, it's like you have to do it 100% right. And it's very difficult. And it also, in a way, is a little bit of a conflict with our embrace of the open web and how when you have an account on micro.blog, you have a blog on the web. And how does that work if posts are private, like just with a family? So there's a lot to think through with that. And I don't know what we're going to do for that use case. But for the use case that I described of having like a kind of like a semi hidden blog where you're sharing it with family members, but it is actually on the web if you know how to get to it. And maybe it's not indexable by Google and maybe it's impossible to discover, but it actually is on the web. For that use case, I think micro.blog is great for that. And I'd love to figure out and hear feedback on ways that we can make that Teams plan more useful and maybe even more affordable to families, because I know that's a bit of a roadblock right now as well. So it's a great question.
Yeah. All right. Well, the next question that we got is from Simon Woods, who's at Simon Woods on micro.blog. And also he is the publisher of Today I Learned at TIL, which is a great resource for keeping up with what's happening at micro.blog. So I just suggest you check out at TIL. And in that vein, Simon says, the team released a surprising number of big updates this year. Has there been or is there still anything particularly difficult about adapting to the effects of the pandemic?
Good question. I'm not sure. It's in some cases, because we're a remote team, some things hadn't changed when everybody, mm-hmm. that was working in an office went back to working at home. We've always done that. So our communication and how we work on problems hasn't changed. I think the impact has mostly been kind of just an emotional impact of just like dealing with everything that's going on. So everybody's gone through this in some form. And I think it affects a business too, like micro.blog, which is so small of like, there are kind of ups and downs of like focusing on different types of work and just the distractions with everything that's going on with the pandemic. So I would say that has been the biggest impact. But in terms of when we set out to work on something and release a feature, I don't think it's much different than it was before the pandemic.
I mean, the only thing that I feel is that, we had to commit it ourselves to once a year, hanging out in person, and having like a kind of an annual review and goal setting and all that, which works a lot better in person if you can do it. And also I miss going to Austin, and we also don't get to meet up at WWDC, where we've had some good meetups, and that's been where we've been able to get you know, a good read from people in person about what's happening at micro.blog. But yeah, feature wise, I don't know, maybe there's been even more new things released. So let me see. Jason Burke has a question, who is at Burke, B-U-R-K, on micro.blog, and also
saved the live stream today.
Saved the live stream, designed the sticker, has helped build out the whole MicroCamp infrastructure. So, but he's also got a question, which is, let's say the business type stuff was all accounted for, yada, yada, yada. It's Jason. You can hire three people. What would be your top three positions you would find the most beneficial to micro.blog as it stands today?
This is a great question. I have an immediate answer, and I'm curious, Jean, if you have the same answer or if we differ, because we've talked about how we could grow the team, but I don't think we've talked about it specifically in this framing of like three people. So my answer is the first person would be a customer support person to help with email.
Yes, agreed.
I sometimes I'm great at email and sometimes I'm not. And I think having someone else, even on a part-time basis, that could be the front lines for email, making sure people are taken care of, I think that would be really, really helpful. So that is my number one. Second person would be someone on the community management side and helping Gene with Discover and just everything like that. That would be my number two pick. And then my number three person would be like a system administrator kind of person to help with servers. And if we ever have downtime, we're preventing that from happening and and helping plan how servers are upgraded and managed and all that kind of thing. As I talked about with Vincent, he's been a huge help with some of the web backend stuff. But I think having someone that's just kind of focused on some of the server administration would also be really useful. So those are my top three. I don't know, Gene, what are your top three?
Well, definitely support. And we have talked about that that's a goal, because everything that you put into support is time that we don't move forward with the platform, or time that you don't get to chill out and you know, have work-life balance. Same for somebody to help out with community tasks like curation or organizing, say, meetups. I mean, I've had some big ideas about how to help people get to know each other online, you know, not just on the timeline, but there's only so many hours that I can devote to this, and it would be great to have somebody on a little, community team. Servers, above my pay grade, so I don't have a true opinion about that. And I can't think of, I think we could work with one thing we could work with, maybe not a team, regular position, but we could devote some resources to web designer, a new interaction designer, somebody who helps us with micro.blog as it appears on the web and what the onboarding is for new users. So, because I think that's been a concern of ours, and also, we get that feedback a lot that, even though it feels somewhat simple, it's still it's daunting to, it could be daunting setting up your domain name and pointing it at your micro.blog, understanding exactly what's happening on micro.blog. So that would be helpful. That would be something I would like help with, because it's we're kind of too close to it at this point, and having some fresh eyes on the whole matter would help. So I'm going to turn to some of the questions in the that are popping up in the discussion. This is a question from Amit. who is at Amit on micro.blog and also one of our presenters tomorrow at MicroCamp. Are there plans to improve the editor on the web? Same for better support for drafts posts?
Yes, great question. I'm glad you asked this. I started working on a new web editor a couple months ago, I guess. For people who don't use the web version very much, it does have some quirks where like spell check doesn't work on some platforms and things like that. Like it's not a great like kind of citizen of the operating system, I guess was one way to put it. And the reason is because it has the markdown highlighting. And so we use this editor called CodeMirror that provides this markdown highlighting. So as you type markdown or HTML, it looks nice. And the cost of that is that some things do not work as smoothly as they should. So I've gone back and forth on this a little bit. And the plan right now that I tested like about a month or two ago, and it looks really, really good, is to upgrade the version of that component. It's a complete rewrite. And I've tested it on a few platforms and it just works way, way better. So it'll be a really nice upgrade. It will definitely be rolled out this year. I don't know when, but I would say probably in another month or so. So yeah, I know that has been a little bit clunky. And sometimes, to be honest, I don't notice because I use like micro.blog on the Mac. And then every once, you know, I'll use it on the web and then I'll realize something is a little wrong and I'm reminded that I really need to reprioritize that. So thank you for the question. And well, the other part of that question was the
drafts.
Yeah. I think so. I guess maybe we could follow up offline and specifically what you'd like to see with drafts. I do think that there's a couple things that I'm thinking of. Like you can, in the apps and on the web, you can type a post and save it as a draft and then you can publish it. But I think that the few things that could be improved are, changing the date more easily, scheduling posts. Kind of a little known fact is you can actually write and schedule a post from some apps and it will go live at the time that you set. For example, you can use Mars Edit for that. You can set the date, but it's not obvious and there's some problems with that. So like, I think drafts and scheduling posts can definitely be improved.
Cool. Next question from Andrew Doran, who is at adoran2 on micro.blog. Is there a good insurance policy for micro.blog continuing beyond the tenure of the small team running it now? I'm wary of falling in love with platforms as so many I have used and enjoyed have gone away. I can relate to this. And also, you know, hey, as many vitamins as we may take, we're not going to be around forever, but we hope micro.blog will. So Manton, your thoughts?
Yep. I think about this a lot, actually. Just so you know, if anybody's new to micro.blog or they haven't been, you know, following my thoughts on this, I plan on working on micro.blog forever. So obviously I'm not going to live forever, but you know, I've worked a long time in the tech industry and as an Apple developer for, you know, 20, 25 years or whatever. And this is the first thing that is just perfect for me to work on. So I will keep working on this forever. But yes, I would love for it to outlast us. And that's something I think about a lot with just blogs. Like how does, like when you invest so much time in your blog and you're writing for years potentially. And like I mentioned when I was talking about family blogs, those posts are really great to look back on usually. Like the boring post that you posted, when you look back later, I find that stuff fascinating. And so how do we make sure that we can preserve everybody's content for as long as possible? There's a few things we're doing. It doesn't directly answer your question, but I wanted to highlight where there's a few things we're doing that relate to this, like making it easy to have all your posts saved to the Internet Archive. That's checkbox micro.blog. So there's always a copy. Syncing backups to GitHub automatically, having an export of your blog in a couple different formats so you can move it. Obviously having your own domain name so that if you decide to move your blog somewhere else, you can preserve all the links, all the URLs still work. So it's something that is on our mind for sure. And I appreciate the question.
Yeah. I am going to wrap this up with one more question. There are a couple more questions in the discussion chat that I think we could address in the chat itself. But I do want to be mindful of the schedule. And I know some people are already here to see Jazz's presentation on the joy of long form writing, which is coming up next. So could we wrap up with Pete Moore? That's at P.I. Moore, micro.blog. And his question is, going forward, how can we better get out the message of the benefits of the Indian open web? I read about people who aren't using the technology, not having a way to reply and communicate with micro.blog people through their posts. And definitely, it's another question that has been on our minds. And actually, last year at Indie Web Camp, our last foray live, Manton and I put on Indie Web Camp in Austin. And my hack day project was creating a better better documentation about the indie web generally for micro.blog users, but and trying to explain what it means. It is a bit of an amorphous thing. So the many methods and technologies are indie web, you know, either compliant or friendly, and micro.blog has always been intended to be indie web friendly. What do you think? How could we better get that message out and also support people using indie web for the first time?
Yeah, I think this is something that the indie web community is also really conscious of. You know, like we have discussions like in the indie web chat a lot about how if you go to indieweb.org, it can be a little daunting for a lot of people, especially if you get real lost in the wiki and it gets super technical. People will quickly click away, and you know it's too much. It's definitely something that comes up in the indie web community a lot. It's like, how can we make this stuff more accessible? And micro.blog, it's all about making this more accessible because we believe in the open web. We believe that in blogs, and blogs can't just be, you shouldn't have to be a programmer to set up a blog and post photos, and it should be as accessible as possible. With the part about replying, so it used to be a micro.blog, you didn't even have replies. Like, replies were only in the timeline, they weren't on your blog at all, and we added a preference for that, so that when you have the detail post on your blog, you can see other replies, and those include web mentions also. So that helps expand micro.blog beyond just replies from people that are on micro.blog. So if someone has a WordPress blog and they send a web mention to your blog host on micro.blog, that reply will be included on your blog, and in the timeline in some cases. That's great. That's step one, I think. And then the next step is, in that component that shows replies on your blog post, there really needs to be a way for anybody to post a reply. And just like how we're used to from 10 years ago.
From the blog, yeah. Classic blogging.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, add a comment. And so how do we do that without like comment spam and all that kind of thing? And I thought about it, and I think it will be straightforward. And for example, if you're signed into micro.blog already, we can know that, and then you could just comment on someone's blog directly, which would also help, like if you're following their blog in a feed reader or something, and you open it up in a browser, and then you can just reply directly, and it kind of flows into the timeline and everything. So yeah, there's a lot we can do, but that second step of like making it easier to reply for non-micro.blog users, we still need to kind of roll that out.
Yeah. I got to say, one more question sort of slid in that I feel like if we give it a short answer, I just can't resist, from Pat Dryberg, who is at Pat Dryberg on micro.blog, which is, what have been the most surprising and or uplifting experiences you've had since the launch of micro.blog? For me, I mean, there have been many, But the most uplifting thing, you know, that comes to mind is the photo blogging challenge we ran last year, which was called A Day in the Life of Microdot Blog. And everybody submitted a photo taken on that day in that 24-hour period, of course, because that's when I first started learning the joy of time zone and seeing everybody's photos coming in over that 24-hour period and just feeling just so happy getting this one slice of humanity and positive content. And that's still available if you want to view the photos. They are on micro.blog/discover/a-day-in-the-life. And we still want to do some more with those photos, but that's my choice, most uplifting. And maybe after MicroCamp is over and technical difficulties have been solved, it will go up in ranking to most uplifting experience.
Yeah, my first thought with surprising was going to be the audio not working today. That in the last 4 years, that has been the most surprising thing. I did not expect that not to work. For uplifting, I think I agree with you. I think just seeing people's content, and I'm not thinking of a specific example, but yours of the photo challenge is perfect. Knowing that we helped enable someone to share something beautiful or amazing or interesting or whatever on the web is very inspiring. So that goes for me too.
Cool. All right. Well, Jazz has been waiting patiently. The Jazz followers have been waiting patiently for his presentation to start. So I'll close this out here. I am glad we built a lot of extra time into this schedule, and we will make things happen. There are meetups, and I am going to give some attention to that while Jazz is presenting to see if we can push those out a little bit too. But thanks, everybody, for being patient, and thanks for being here at MicroCamp.
Thanks.